Hello, everyone. Welcome to Hyperspace on Dark Matter Radio Network. I'm your host, Solaris BlueRaven. I want to thank everybody for tuning in this evening, and a special thank you to webmaster and producer Keith Rowland. And my special guest this evening is Barbara DeLong, internationally renowned spiritual intuit, medium, channel, author, artist, lecturer, and ordained minister. Barbara DeLong has been working professionally in the spiritual field since the early 70s, in addition to being a full-time special education teacher and a single parent. In the 80s, she began painting personal mandalas for friends. Since that time, her paintings and the life readings that go with them are now worldwide, with over 400 of them in private collections. These individual paintings evolved into a circular oracle card deck called the Cosmic Deck of Initiation. The deck was published in 1991 as a peaceful and more spiritual substitute to the standard tarot deck, with many thousands purchased around the world. Robert toured the country with the Cosmic Deck of Initiation for over 5 years, presenting them at conventions and bookstores nationwide. Barbara has done numerous radio and television shows and conventions and is listed in Hans Holzer's book, The Psychic Yellow Pages, The Very Best Psychics, Card Readers, Astrologers, and Numerologists. Her readings come from a deep spiritual background and are focused on giving the individual understanding of the pathway they are on and positive insight on how to enable the creative energies within to expand on the human experience. The readings give a 12-month glimpse and go from the mundane to the magical. As an ordained minister, spiritual minister, Barbara served a local spiritualist church as one of the rotating ministers from 2003 to 2008. Her platform mediumship was considered both accurate and inspired. Her website, Barbara DeLong, Spiritual Empath, is a teaching site combining personal information and a plethora of spiritual, material, and energetic forecasts for each week of the year. Barbara offers private and phone readings, as well as parties and organizational functions. She's also available for stores and conventions and at psychic fairs run by Programs for Human Development, or PhD. In October of 2009, she launched her own radio show called Night Light, which features spiritual philosophy, questions and answers, and free psychic readings. The show also offers a platform for planting seeds of spiritual insight, as well as a showcase for featured psychics offering insight from a plethora of different modalities. Barbara is now also a Reiki master. Secrets of the Stones is a recent project Barbara has been involved in. She wrote and narrated and is co-producer of this video that is in the process of being converted to a major documentary feature, drawing attention to aspects of our past that have been more or less flown beneath the radar, has become a crusade of sorts and is in the process of being converted to a major documentary film. That should be good. Her newest project is in her book, Whispers of Spiritual Wisdom, published by Oracle Publishing. It is a collection of her poetry and short, insightful spiritual insights. The book has gotten impressive reception, and the next book is in the works. And we're looking forward to that one, too. And her websites are, but let's see here, we have www.barbaradelong.com. We've got www.blogtalkradio.com/nightlight and www.carepress.com/Barbara DeLong. And please welcome Barbara to the show this evening. Hi, Barbara.
Good. How does anybody live up to a bio like that?
I'm telling you, man. I'm sucking air.
there are a lot of hosts that I just say, please just say, here's Barbara, make up your own mind.
And
I'd really rather that.
Oh, well, geez, I could have just cut it all down to nothing then. I want to make sure I read it for you anyways. It was very impressive and I wanted to share that with everybody. But, well, yeah, welcome to the show. It's great to have you on this evening.
It's delightful to be here.
Yeah, I'm glad to have you on. We have so much to discuss tonight. And I know we were talking about a few things off air. So I do want to touch base with you insofar as what you've been up to currently.
Currently, I guess my latest project, although I've been working on giants because they began to fascinate me. So I've done a lot of research on the giants, especially the giants in the U.S. And I'm actually running a spiritual development circle on Blog Talk Radio because I discovered that a lot of people who are in the field and doing readings don't have any idea as to the spiritual foundation behind what it is they say they can do.
Mm-hmm. Excellent.
So I figured, you know, just because I'm old school, and at 70, I can be old school. So it just, to me, if you don't understand the foundation of what you say you're practicing, then you have a problem.
Mm-hmm. Totally.
And, you know, so many people say, I'm psychic, I'm going to go do readings and make a fortune. Big joke. Or they say, I'm a light worker and I'm a psychic. And, you know, I've taken 3 workshops, so I'm a master psychic now. Or you know, basically my philosophy is, whoever or whatever you are is known by your deeds and your words and your actions, mm-hmm. not by the certificates you have on the wall.
Absolutely. Yeah, I totally agree with that. And I believe you're correct. You know, I was thinking about that today also. There are so many people who are just kind of watered down in so far as their teachings go and their spiritual paths go. And of course, it's like martial arts. It's a lifestyle. So it's not just about taking a course or a class here and there and then becoming an expert. Literally, it's a lifestyle and a life-changing event.
Oh, gosh, yeah. I ran into a woman down in Virginia one night when I was down there working at a bookstore. And she had just finished a weekend workshop, and she introduced herself to me very reverently, I laughed. And she said that she was a shaman. And I said, you know, fantastic. What tradition are you a shaman in? And she said, I'm a shaman. And I said, yeah, but what tradition did you study in? Well, I just finished a 3-day workshop and I'm a shaman. And I said, do you have a certificate? And she said, yes. I said, I think you should burn it and not say you're a shaman. Let people know you're a shaman by how you deal with them. Mm-hmm. And she just looked at me and I said, I hope you didn't pay a lot of money for that, because any Native American that you say you're a shaman to is going to laugh at you.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Yeah. And there's a lot of that going on too. Yeah. And I noticed you're also a Reiki master.
I am.
Yeah,
I am.
And I noticed that also. Have you noticed that there's like mass initiations now with Reiki and this and that?
Well, you know, it used to be Reiki was, you know, not as much in the main venue as it is today. And mm-hmm. to be honest, I didn't take it to learn healing. I took it because their attunements were really cool, and I wanted the attunements because it expanded consciousness, and that's what I was aiming at. So, you know, I took the workshops and I did the work, and I am a Reiki master, but I tell people you don't need to be, you know, you don't need the certificate unless you want to, you know, charge other people a lot of money to become Reiki masters. To me, all the symbols are out there on the internet. If you type in Reiki symbol and you go to images, they're all there. And to be honest with you, true healers don't need anything like that in order to do their work. Mm-hmm. And true healers bring their healing techniques from lifetimes past. So that, I mean, Reiki is a reasonably new modality. It's really not an ancient anything. So, but you know, to be fair to Reiki, a good practitioner can really help people in lots of different ways. But Reiki 1 and Reiki 2 are both 1-day workshops. How much can you learn and how much can you absorb in just a day,
right,
or 2 days?
Yeah, I totally agree with you. And I do believe that you're right, that we're born with a lot of these gifts from past lifetimes or even future. But yeah, totally. Yep.
Yeah, so it's, you know, it's a matter of, if you need a piece of paper, you really have a problem.
Mm-hmm. Totally, I agree.
And yet I have two master's degrees in education, but the only thing that proves is that I had the money to pay for the coursework. It just, you know, and the only reason I did that was because there were pay raises connected to each master's. Mm-hmm. So, and I have to tell you that in all of my education as far as teaching goes, there's not one thing there that I have ever used in any professional work that I've done. Mm-hmm. So, although a lot of it has come in handy recently with, you know, teaching on the internet and everything, not that it's lesson plans and stuff like that, it's more or less an understanding that you assume everybody knows nothing and then you can't go wrong.
Right. Well said. Without a doubt. And I did want to ask you a bit about your husband, Patrick Cook.
Yes.
Let's elaborate a little bit on that insofar as who he is. And he's still there, out there in the universe.
Well,
okay.
Yes. Yeah, he passed away 2 years ago. Okay. Patrick, it was a fascinating man. He was a biblical theologian. He was trained as a Baptist minister, though he never actually practiced. He was taught autodidactically, so that his whole, you know, his whole field of knowledge was something that he picked up on his own. He was an expert in the Bible. He had his website, The Bible UFO Connection, which is no longer up, but what was up, was the largest compilation of UFO material that was on the internet for the longest period of time. And he was the very first one over 15 years ago to start saying that the that there were UFOs and extraterrestrials in the Bible. And he proved it. And he went through the Bible and he pulled out all of the UFO sightings and all of the extraterrestrial experiences. And it was fantastic. His book, The Bible UFO Connection, is really an amazing amount of reference work to those aspects in the Bible. And it does make you kind of stand back and think, okay, they were seeing things back then they didn't understand, and they wrote them in the only way that they knew, the only vocabulary they had. If they had the words UFOs and extraterrestrial back then, the Bible would be a completely different book.
Mm-hmm. It certainly would have. Yeah.
And probably more appropriately, just the teachings of Jesus would have been better, because a lot of their other stories are just for the birds.
Mm-hmm. I totally agree with you. And was Patrick a contactee?
No, he was not a contactee. He'd never seen a UFO. He just, you know, Patrick was a very, I guess, cut and dried person. If he could prove it, if he could read it, and prove it, then it was okay. If it was in the Bible and stuff, then he could work with it. But when it came to a lot of the, you know, that leap of faith into where other realms, other dimensions, stuff like that, he was very, I doubt it. As a matter of fact, his website on it, that he talked about psychics and he trashed us to, you know, just absolutely trashed us.
Well, there's so many that are just like not for real. I think that's why, and they give the real legitimate ones a bad name.
Well, that's true. That's true. But you know, there's good and bad in every field. And I like to think there's a modality, there's a person out there for everybody, whether you need to have money taken away from you, or you need to be lied to, or you want to know spiritual stuff, or you want to know the truth. I mean, there's somebody for everybody.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yep. Well said indeed. And his book, The Bible UFO Connection, is that what it's called? It's still around, correct?
Oh yeah, it's available on Amazon. Okay. And he had two other books too. One was The Lost Books of the Bible, The Real Apophrica, and the other one was Destiny of Man. I forget them. Isn't that terrible? There are three of them. If you go on Amazon and you put Patrick Cook in with an E, you'll find him.
Okay, and all of his archives now, all that data he acquired over the years, do you have access to that still? Do you keep a file of it somewhere?
You mean the website? Actually, his
original.
Three.
Yeah.
His three books are the website.
Okay. Excellent.
So that anybody who, you know, wants to have the whole website, a lot of people just went in and downloaded it, and it was close to 9,000 pages.
My goodness.
So it was huge.
Wow.
And but for the longest time, he was the only voice out there. He was attacked. He was criticized. And if you look at Ancient Aliens, when they started out with their series, they were basically using the Zachariah Sitchin material, and they were talking about evil aliens and all sorts of stuff. And then as the years went by, most of the people that are now on the Ancient Aliens series called Patrick and asked if they could use his material.
Nice.
I mean, Georgios Sakalas and a whole bunch of.
Wow. So they're just regurgitating his original information.
Exactly.
My goodness.
And of course, 2 weeks before he passed away, he was actually filmed for Ancient Alien series. So, and it's you can't imagine how strange it is to be, you know, coming out of the bathroom with the TV and hearing my husband talk to me from the TV. I mean, that's strange.
Oh, no kidding. Wow. And I think it's so cute how you all met. So I'd like to share that with everybody.
Oh, sure. I started doing Blog Talk Radio in 2007. And one of the things that, you know, helped to get me where I am today, one of the things that actually changed my life forever, was actually seeing a UFO and it landed on my campus. And I told everybody about it and was accused of drinking too much or whatever. And I had 30 years of this, and finally I met a man who had written a book about the authenticated sightings that are here in the USA, and that instance where my campus is one of them. And so I had him on my show, and I was interviewing him. And my show has always been spiritually oriented and just doing readings or spiritual philosophy and stuff like that. And but this was the very first time ever, and I've not done one since, I did a show on UFOs. And Patrick, who cruised around Blog Talk Radio a lot in the paranormal field, was looking for something to listen to, and he couldn't find anything in paranormal, so he reluctantly went over to the spirituality category, and he saw that I was doing something on UFOs, and he sat in and he listened, and he kept trying to contact me and say, you know, I'm an expert in the field and I've published books in the field, and, you know, pull me on, I want to talk too. And finally, when the other author had to leave, I pulled him on, and we talked for about half the show. And after we got off the show, he wrote me and he said that he'd love to talk with me some more. And he gave me his all his credentials and his bio and everything, so I would know he wasn't a stalker. And I figured he's 3,000 miles away. What can this hurt? So we started talking, and we talked for hours and hours and hours. And we just kept it up for months and months and months. And he asked me to be co-host on his show, which was Matrix Radio. And I was. And so the more and more we talked, the more and more we realized there was a synchronicity, there was a commonality. And at one point, he sent me an article that he was going to send to one of the magazines he published in. And, you know, I read it and I called him and I said, well, what do you want me to do? Critique it, spell check it, play with it. And he said, you know, at the time, well, just see what you can do with it. And he actually thought, I write beautifully. How could she possibly make it any better? So I did. And I sent it back. And he said, well, I guess I never write alone again. And from there on, we started, you know, also collaborating on writing stuff and articles. And after about 8 months of talking, sometimes 16, 18 hours a day, he said, you know, why don't we just move in together? And you know, I don't know why, but I said, okay. And so that June, I flew to San Francisco to meet him for the first time. And he picked me up in his van with his three cats and everything he owned. And our first date was driving 3,000 miles across the country. And, you know, if that doesn't ruin a relationship, nothing will. He moved in. And we continued to work together and work on the documentary Secrets of the Stones. And that following February, we had decided we weren't going to get married because we were both over 60 and that just didn't make any sense. And he said, I can't find a Valentine for you. Will you marry me? And I said, okay. And we justice of the peace did, and then came home and raked leaves. And a year and a half later, he passed.
But still, you had some magical times. That seems like it was so fated on so many levels, your encounter with him, just for, even if it was a brief time.
Well, you know, I said to him, and he had to agree that it was a cosmic manipulation, absolutely.
Mm-hmm. I agree, totally.
So it was really every now and then, you know, because he was so totally paranormal and I was so totally spiritual that we did rub off on each other. And he mellowed a lot. He still didn't believe in psychics or mediums, actually. Mm-hmm. And he would take me to the fairs that I worked, and you know, when I did spirit circles. But he would never sit in on one. And he didn't want to have anything to do with the spirit circle. He didn't want to have anything to do with. He always said, "I don't know what you do, but you do it very well." And when he was in a coma. The night before he passed, I was sitting in the room talking to him, and the nurse came in and said, I understand you're a medium. And I said, yes. And she just looked at me and she kind of said, well, I said, your grandmother's here. Is it who you want to talk to? And she said, yes. And so I talked to her I gave her grandmother's messages for about 20 minutes. She sobbed all the way through it. Mm. And she finally said, I have to get back to work. I said, you know, wonderful, but don't tell anybody else because I really don't want to have a string of people in here. And after she was gone, I sat and looked at this man in a coma and I said, well, it took on your deathbed and in a coma, but you finally saw what a reading was like with the mediumship. And, you know, and I had to laugh because it was probably the only way he was ever going to listen to one.
That's amazing. And, you know, when you think about the paranormal in general and UFOs, obviously they all dovetail into spirituality.
Well, not as far as he was concerned.
Interesting. I wonder what that was that really kept him from embracing that.
Well, he was very into the Bible and what the Bible had to say. And not that he was not a religious man. He was spiritual, but he was more into the UFO aspect of it. You know, UFOs and extraterrestrials, the spiritual side of things, the other dimensions, and being able to perceive what's going to happen, you know, bringing information from the future that had potential for evolving into reality. No, absolutely not.
Wow. Interesting. Well, you were a good compliment for him then, without a doubt.
Well, it was funny. He believed that there was no such thing as reincarnation, that it was all genetic memory. I believe in reincarnation and a little genetic. I think it's both. Mm-hmm. And we lost many a night of sleep trying to argue it and prove it and stuff like that. Mm. I actually did prove it slightly with him with the fact that at one point in the New Testament, Jesus does say something about being the God of the Old Testament. And I said, well, what's that? And he said, well, that's reincarnation. I said, well, there. And he said, it was okay for him, but not for you. So we finally agreed that whoever died first was going to find out what it was and come back and tell the other one. Mm. And I haven't heard from him, so I have to assume I was right.
There you go.
So, you know, he's the kind that would not come back and say, well, you're right. Never. Mm-hmm. Not even on the other side in spirit. I think his ego was that strong.
That's funny. So can you elaborate a little bit on the UFO encounter you had on campus and what it looked like and what year was this?
Sure. It was 66, I think. It was in the spring of 66. It was during that time frame when they were having all the swamp gas and everything. Mm-hmm. And they had sent Hynek out to Michigan to check out a lot of the sightings that were reported there. It was on an evening so that the windows were open in the dorms. It was after it was right up close to 11 o'clock. The dorm was locked at 11, so we were locked in. And we heard a flash just before 11 that there had been a UFO spotted over the campus, that the three local airports had diverted all of their flights and were closed down, and that the police were checking it out. And 11 o'clock hit, and we heard police cars streaking to the campus. And the campus was a very late, you know, it was quiet, and it was a campus. It was mm-hmm. quiet. There was not a lot going on, especially after 11. Police cars came streaking in, and we heard on their radios that it had landed on the baseball stadium. Now, there was a building between my window and my dorm and the baseball stadium. So we heard them say, we're going to turn the stadium lights on and so we can get a better look. We saw the stadium lights go on, the glow in the sky. Mm-hmm. And it was a saucer. It rose up and it swept over my dorm. It closed, it blanked out the entire sky. It was I keep trying to figure out exactly how far above the dorm it must have been, could not have been more than 200 feet above the dorm.
Mm, wow.
If it had had a VIN number, I could have read it. And then it just absolutely, it just went and it was gone. Now, there was no air displacement. There was no sound of the sound barrier being broken. There was no there was no noise. It just was there and it was gone. Mm-hmm. And so we waited for 12 o'clock at night to hear what they said on the radio. There was nothing. It was a total news blackout.
Wow.
And you know, we were, I mean, one of the airports that we, there was an Air Force camp right near the campus. So they, there was military police the whole rest of the evening, and policemen, they were all in pairs with German Shepherds. They patrolled the entire campus.
That's interesting. So it wasn't one of ours manufactured from the Air Force, you don't think, do you?
No way.
Okay. Yeah.
No.
Wow. So what was the vibration you got off of the saucer? I mean, what was the energetic associated with that?
It was really funny. When I saw it, it was sort of like, holy crap, we're not alone. And I did not get, I was not frightened. I was not at all scared. Nobody was, you know, it was like, wow, look at that. And, you know, in the movies, you see screaming and panic and riot and everything. There was none of that. None of us felt that. It was sort of like, they're a part of us. They come from home. It was, you know, we didn't really talk that much about it, but it, for me, it changed my perception of my reality. I think in many ways it woke up parts of me that you know, were dormant, and it got me on the pathway of a spiritual investigation, of spiritual development, of trying to expand myself more greatly into the whatever talents and skills that I brought forward through time. While I did actually, you know, finish and graduate with a teaching degree, and I taught school for 25 years, there was always that other part of me that was looking for other spiritual aspects, looking for other ways to expand myself. And it was almost like whoever was in that saucer, whoever, whatever, you know, were just like me, but they had greater awareness. Mm-hmm. So that it was sort of like that I'm capable of that too. Right. And so I think in a way I do believe that's why we're seeing so many of the sightings all over the country, and where a lot of them are flying much more slowly so that people can get a good look at them, and I do feel that they're sort of helping us to get used to the idea that they're out there. Because, I mean, the Phoenix Lights, thousands of people saw that spaceship go, you know, up, you know, across Phoenix. Even with the Battle of Los Angeles in World War II, I mean, that was a UFO that we actually fired on. And there were like energy shields of some sort, because nothing ever hit the UFO, and a number of people were killed, were collateral damage from our bombs coming back and falling on the populace.
Mm-hmm. Right.
So no, I think that if they meant harm, they would have done it a long time ago.
Right. Yeah, I tend to agree with you on that one. And did the craft interfere at all with electricity?
No, not at all.
Okay. Wow. That's really interesting. So when it blipped out, or did it blip out, or did it kind of phase shift? What did it look like when it left?
It was over the dorm, and it was huge. It was so big that it covered the dorm. I don't know what the diameter would have been, but whatever the diameter of a baseball field is, that's about what it was. And we saw it streak. You know, there was kind of like a streak. You knew that it had gone towards a much larger glowing point in the sky. And the rest of the evening we watched, and probably 12 or 15 other lights rose up from the earth and went out to that one main light. And then that one main light took off. So, you know, I don't know what it landed for. I just
makes you wonder, doesn't it?
It does. And you know, I told everybody that it was picking up some people or something. You know, it doesn't make sense that it landed, to tell you the truth, but it Right. did. And they investigated it, and there was radioactivity on the field. So it was very obviously there.
Oh, yeah. Did you see windows or no?
I didn't see any windows. It glowed colors. There were colors. I saw orange, and I saw yellow, and I saw a couple green. But But, you know, other than, and it was the metal glowed those colors. It wasn't like it was a light or a headlight there. It was the whole area of the ship glowed that color.
Oh, wow. That sounds pretty cool.
It was super. It was really great.
Even That's a though, blessing. Nobody gets to see those like that. That's awesome.
No, it was really cool. And I just, you know, you see things like that and you want to go for a ride. No, you want to know why are you here? And I firmly believe that they are, you know, I do believe in the law of one that as everyone on the planet is of a family, that we are all connected. We all came from the same place. Those same energies, those same spirit energies are all over the galaxy, and we all come from the same place. So that you know, when you see somebody, it's sort of like being in kindergarten and seeing a member of the family who has a PhD. Mm-hmm. You know, and you kind of want to tap in and just talk to them for a little while. You just, I know there are people like Billy Meyer who does, you know, meet with them and talk with them, and he brings prophecies and everything from them. But, you know, I'm not so much into, you know, the future of humanity is to their history, right, where they came from.
Exactly. And why they're here. And how long was the craft on the ground, would you say?
Oh, wow. Probably between 5 and 10 minutes, I would think.
My goodness, that's a pretty good amount of time.
Well, it you know,
I would have gone after it. I would have gone outside.
Well, we were locked in the dorms. That was when, you know, 11 o'clock. You, right. I mean, it that would have definitely caused chaos.
Yeah.
But interestingly enough, one of the boys in one of the boys' dorms, boys were not locked in. He took a tape recorder out. And he got very close, and he did a lot of tape recording. And this is before digital cameras and stuff like that. And I don't know if he took pictures or not, but I know that he had a lot of recordings. And the next day, you know, the men in black, they're real. They came and they got him, and they got everything that he had in his dorm room, and we never saw him back on campus again.
Oh, my goodness. And what did these men in black look like?
Men in black suits.
It's just a typical, yeah, okay.
Yes, sunglasses, you know, right. They had hats, too.
My goodness, that's incredible. What a bummer. Would it be nice to get our hands on that tape, huh?
Yeah. And you know, from where I was, I didn't hear anything. Mm-hmm. But apparently there were noises or hums or something.
Right.
I don't know. There were others that, you know, saw it, that were with him, but didn't have any recordings or anything. So they were left alone.
That's an amazing story. That's incredible. I don't know how many people talk about that these days.
You know? Well, you know, now you're getting all these people who say they're abductees.
Right.
And I mean, I will buy in a heartbeat Benny and Barney Hill. Because she drew a star map that she couldn't possibly have known where the stars were.
Mm-hmm, right.
Until what, 10 years later, 15 years later, they were discovered.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of the other abductee experiences only come out in hypnosis. And I really am very leery of that.
Me too. Yeah, I agree with you on that. Well, there's also the MyLabs too. I don't know how much you've done research on that, but that's my area, and military abductions where they're being programmed with psychotronic programming. And yeah, just about any scenario can take place with the technology. So,
absolutely.
Yeah, so that's another avenue that's kind of more the creepy side of what they're doing. But yeah, I totally agree with you. They're the legitimate ones, though. The legitimate cases that I find fascinating. And even your experience, to me, that's like, I mean, how many people get to see that in their lifetime?
Not a lot, I guess.
Nobody. I mean, honestly, I don't know anybody. And when it lands, because I've always asked that, you know, why don't they ever land? That's my biggest beef. You know, people see all these craft and none of them actually land. So.
Well, there, who was it? What is his name? Nicholas Rosler wrote the book In Focus. And in one of his documented sightings, there was a man who was able to walk up to one that had landed. And he touched it, and he had horrific burns. So there are some cases where they actually have landed, and people have gone up to them. I think one of the men was able to look inside, but I'm not sure. Frankly, I read the whole book, but I hit my incidents, and that's all she wrote. You know?
Wow, that's fascinating. And so, have the men in black ever bothered you or your husband when he was alive with all the information you were accessing?
Men in black
or anybody similar?
Well, I was in Newport News once and doing, I did a lot of readings down in Newport News for almost 10 years. And we got a lot of our Army and Navy and Air Force and personnel because their base is all over the place there.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the times I was reading a man, he was in civilian clothes. He and his wife came in, they wanted a reading together and they sat down and I looked at him. I didn't even have the cards out, I don't think. And I said to him, "What kind of clearance does your wife have?" And he said, "She doesn't have any clearance. Why would she need clearance?" And I said, "Now I'm going to have to ask her to leave the room." And his wife just looked at him and he said, "Well, let's see what she's got. Go ahead, you know." And I said to him, "You've just come from a meeting that the folder said top secret on it." And he started to get the color was draining out of his face. And I said, "You know, I understand going to a psychic, you know, for fun, but you have to take it seriously because some of us really are for real." And I said, the meeting was on something top secret. And I said, "I know you doubt, so I'm going to explain stuff to you. The meeting was top secret. It was on something that the government is going to do. Your uniform will look very different from the uniform you wear now. And it's going to create a lot of political havoc." It was a month before Desert Storm.
Hmm. Wow.
And the next day, the military police were outside the store and stopped every military person from coming in.
My goodness. I guess you hit a nerve there.
Could be.
Yeah. That's good on your end, but well, you know, they should take it seriously, you know, when they're getting a reading, I would say. That's fascinating.
Well, you know, the military does use psychics.
Oh, absolutely.
So
they recruit them. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I'm surprised they didn't recruit you.
No. I have too much fun at this, you know.
Yeah.
And if I ever saw anything that was, you know, unethical, I would certainly blow the whistle and that would, you know, I'd probably be in a padded cell someplace. No, I wouldn't want to play with the stuff they play with. You know, our government is into a lot of things that I think the founding fathers would be very angry at.
Mm-hmm. I agree. Yeah, I've experienced some of it too. That's a long story. But yeah, that's fascinating. And I did want to switch gears a little bit and talk about the secrets of the stones because I thought that was fascinating when I heard you lecture about that. And I saw your video. So can we go there?
Sure. When Patrick was still out in California, he found a single YouTube, I don't know, 4 or 5 minute thing on a stone chamber. And he said, "Do you know anything about these? And, you know, or do you know anything? And I said, "My God, I live in the middle of them. They're all over the place." And so we started, you know, to look into, once he got out here, to look into them more and more and more. And these are stone chambers that they're very old. They're very old. They're made of stones and there's no mortar or anything that holds them together. And they're made in with corbelled construction, which means, you know, it's like you stack dominoes, you know, closer and closer and closer till you make almost a dome. That's how the stones are. And in many cases, the stones that make up the roof and certainly the lintel are thousands of pounds. They're very, very heavy. And they're all over the place here. Originally, there were about 2,000 of them. Now there are only about 200. Mm-hmm. They're on people's property. They're in fields. They're most of them are connected to stone walls, and there are stone walls here in New England that, I mean, you can't you can't spit without hitting one. Mm-hmm. And when we started to look into it, we discovered that the stone walls in I think it's 1872, the Department of Agriculture did a survey, and they found that there were over 500,000 miles of stone walls in New England, and that doesn't count New York State. That's enough to go around the world 10 times or to the moon and back. Mm-hmm. Now, the early settlers didn't make them. And the stone chambers as well. There are letters from early colonists asking about them. The Native American Indians that are indigenous to the region did not do them. They and as far as stone walls go, they never built walls. They you know, felt that they were guests on the land, that they had no right to do that. Mm-hmm. So all of this had to be done by either another race or another species. In some sites, there are carbon dating. They were able to carbon date charcoal back to about 4,000 BC.
Wow, my goodness.
But as far as artifacts or anything like that, they've never found any. So it's, you know, Patrick and I felt very strongly that they should be protected in some way. And so we did the documentary hoping that people would realize that we're destroying a legacy from the past. And without giving it the proper respect, I mean, if some of these go back past, you know, 4,000 years, you know, they're preserving colonial homes that are only a couple hundred years old, and they're using these amazing stone chambers as garages and places to put their garbage. And a lot of people have just taken them apart and used the stones for their patios.
Oh, wow. Yeah. What a disservice. And do you know if these structures are built along the ley lines of the planet?
Some of them are and some of them aren't. It looks pretty random. Some of them are on the north side, the east-west. You know, they're situated for the solstices. Mm-hmm. Not all of them, but a lot of them. And they're not huge. I mean, there are some that are big, but for the most part, they're not much more than maybe 6 feet tall. And, you know, the largest one I think I was ever in was about 20 feet by 10 feet. So they're not, and you know, the given historical explanation is that they were cold storage for, you know, settlers to keep their food in for the winter. Of course, they don't have cross ventilation and they don't have doors, and food would rot in them immediately if the scavengers didn't get it. They aren't burial sites because I would have sensed that. Mm-hmm. And I think that the most fascinating thing about all these stone chambers, every one that I've been in, and I've been in probably 100 to 150 of them, you get the same feeling you get when you're in a crop circle. It's almost as though a dome of silence has been put over you. Everything is muffled, and it's quiet, and it's peaceful, and it's safe.
Nice.
And underline safe. Now, some of them are right next to roads. You don't hear the traffic going by. Some of them are definitely in deep woods or on mountains that are part of national parks and stuff. But it has a feeling in it that is otherworldly. They're mostly made of granite with some quartz in them. And they are, like as I said, they're mostly always, not always always, but mostly always connected by stone walls, which to me said, I wonder if this is some sort of communication grid.
Right.
Or teleportation grid. They have in there are more sightings over the areas with the stone chambers than in other parts of the countries in the country. Mm-hmm. We did as much as we could. The documentary was presented at Megalithomania 2011, and it was amazing the interest that we got. And on my website, the video is there, but also there are maps of where the stone structures and the stone chambers are in this country, and for the stone chambers in New England, a lot of them are GPS, so people can actually go see them themselves.
Oh, that's wonderful. Yeah. Were there any glyphs or anything like that?
No, nothing.
Okay.
At American Stonehenge in New Hampshire, there are some glyphs, but and it is the same time frame. But that is almost a settlement as opposed to the individual stone chambers that we saw. Mm-hmm. I don't think they're connected to the Serpent Mound and things like that. I think they predate it. Mm-hmm. So, but as far, you know, Patrick just said he didn't know and that he wanted to protect them. I think that there's a level of our evolution that you know, we're missing, and that may be connected to it, or it could have been a species that is otherworldly. I don't know. Mm-hmm. But I do know that they should be used for more than garbage dumps and garages. I feel they should be, you know, and my idea, my thought was, you know, make it if you have one of these stone walls on your property and you protect it, then you get a cut on your property tax or something. Mm-hmm. But to date, I've seen them destroyed. I've seen them absolutely mowed down to widen a road or something. It's it's awful.
Right.
And there are a lot of, on my website as well, there are hundreds of pictures of stone chambers in all the New England states. Mm-hmm. They're amazing.
Yeah, they certainly are. And it's shameful that they would take them down or destroy them in any way, shape, or form. And did you ever connect in with a race psychically when you were exploring all these areas?
It's funny. The thing that I did find was that I could hear whispers, but I wasn't sure what they were. And I couldn't really discern what it was. Now, I don't know if what I was hearing was an echo of a memory of a whisper, or if I was actually hearing a whisper. I don't know. But, you know, you can't spend enough time there to really be able to discern what's going on. And I've never heard of anybody doing an EVP there. But if I could hear the whisper, then an EVP should have been able to pick it up. Mm-hmm. One interesting thing, though, in the entrance of a number of them, there were magnetic anomalies.
Hmm.
So that, and they never, and they just, you know, they said, yes, there are magnetic anomalies, but they didn't go any further into it.
Huh.
They nobody ever dug down to see if there was anything it that might be causing it or anything like that. So, you know, there's been no research into it. There are a lot of us that have, you know, tried to draw interest to them. But to date, there's not any way to protect them. So I don't know. They will eventually go the way of the dinosaur, I guess.
Oh, I hate to see that. Well, hopefully people pay attention to your documentary and start tuning into that. So the magnetic anomalies, can you describe some of the type of experience you would feel with the magnetic anomalies?
Well, first of all, a compass would go crazy.
Okay.
And if you are sensitive to energy, you feel, I guess, dizzy is the best way to put it.
Okay.
But once you cross the threshold, then you're fine.
Oh, that's interesting.
And if it, as I said, it's similar to, excuse me, it's similar to crop circles. Have you ever been in one?
You know, I haven't. And I know.
Wow.
I know.
That's so cool. In a crop circle, you know, forget even the fact that, you know, the grass is bent, not broken, and all of that stuff. If it's a real crop circle, first of all, there's a smell of ozone. Secondly, there are no bugs. Thirdly, animals will never eat any of the grain or the wheat that came from a crop circle. And energetically, you do feel disoriented. You do feel again that cone of silence type thing where you're isolated. There is an energetic isolation, if you will. I know there are people that lay down and meditate, but I kind of wonder if it's, for want of a better word, just normal people laying down to see what they feel, or if they really have taken spiritual intuits in there to see what they get. I personally think that they are created from an interdimensional ship that moves in, does it, and moves out. so that there is that interdimensional feeling there. So, because the, I mean, they're done in an hour sometimes, sometimes even less.
It's amazing. Yeah, it does sound like there's some kind of a portal there, a gateway of some kind.
Yeah, well, I think those that interdimensionally travel, they just create the portal and then they go. And they've been very careful and they always close the door. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I agree with you totally. I am, after years and years and years of working with UFOs and everything else, I am firmly of the mind that any spacecraft that is in our skies has interdimensionally shifted to that. They haven't traveled through time and space. They haven't traveled through space. Mm-hmm. They've traveled through time.
That makes a lot of sense. And also with these type of portals, or actually the crop circles and your other investigations with these structures, do you think it's activating the DNA and the light body through frequency?
Well, I think, well, for sure, our DNA has aspects to it that have not been awakened or turned on yet. Mm-hmm. I mean, I know there is one that will self-replicate, so that if you lose an arm, it'll grow another arm. Mm-hmm. I mean, we have that gene within our body. It's just not activated.
Right.
And as far as activating... it will activate. I think we're going to fiddle with semantics here. I do believe that if you spend a great deal of time in any of these energy fields, that your energy begins to resonate with them. There, ergo, you awaken aspects within yourself that have always been there, but you haven't known and you didn't know how to access.
Perfect. Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. So that would explain a lot of things. So people get some, I guess, in a way, they get initiated to some degree energetically just by mm-hmm. approaching these areas. That's very sacred to me, because in a world as busy as we have right now, this world, it's good to have these areas where we can kind of go and reset our batteries.
Absolutely. And, you know, I do believe that a lot of people who intentionally go to a place to be awakened and come away don't realize that something has been triggered, but it isn't always what you think should happen. Our perception of what awakening is probably very far from what the actual truth is. Mm-hmm. And when we you know, and this is my opinion, you know, please, just my opinion, Barbara's opinion. This is philosophy according to Barbara. But my feeling is that our awakening is understanding more and more and more our humanity and the fact that we are all one. Mm-hmm. And I do believe that our awakening is a greater understanding in the law of one, which is the big main universal law that has been in play within reality since the beginning of time.
Mm-hmm.
So that it doesn't mean you're going to be psychic, and it doesn't mean that you're going to be a channel or a medium. And frankly, psychic and channels and mediums are merely the side effect of becoming more spiritual. And so many people don't understand that. Mm-hmm. They study psychic and they study channeling, they study mediumship, when in reality, they need to be studying spirituality and creativity and meditation and all of those aspects that lead up to that create the foundation for being a total spiritual entity. And a total spiritual entity is, of course, psychic and a medium and a channel.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Well said. Oh, I totally agree with you on that one. Yeah, it's a lifestyle. It's just about moving to higher levels of consciousness once again. I always talk about the consciousness thing when I have my show. So, but that's really what it's about. Now, what is your impression of the positives and negatives on this planet? There's a polarization. It seems to me like there's a surge of evil, which you would call evil, and there's also the positive. So what do you think is happening here on this world that's creating this rift? Oh, she laughs.
Yeah, I do. I do believe that we have as a human race been led down a path, and that there has to be some corporate form of manipulation going on. Mm-hmm. I negate out the fact I believe there is energy. Mm-hmm. And it can be used positively or negatively. And I do believe that the governments and corporate structures like religions and armies are trying to control the populace as a whole, our culture, at least our culture, and I don't know about others, but I know about ours. Mm-hmm. We're pre-programmed to not be creative. We're pre-programmed to follow along with what we're told to follow along. We're not programmed to think for ourselves or to question.
Right.
And those who question and those who think for themselves end up gone at some point in time. Now, I do believe that there is an overwhelming energetic of corporate manipulation going on, and that it is definitely to the detriment of the individuals and those who are of a spiritual nature.
Mm-hmm. I
agree. So that you know, I would definitely say that right about now the dark side is winning. And this isn't the kind of battle that you fight. You know, you don't go to war with weapons of mass destruction and stuff. You go to war with love and with peace and with kindness. And I do feel that the scales will tip, but it's going to take a long time. And right now there are so many angry people out there that. You know, there's so much anger going on here that people aren't stopping and realizing what's happening to them. They are basically they're being reactionary. And right. That's what happens when fear sets in. You shut down all of the things inside of yourself. And that means you shut down those channels that allow the spirit to access and manifest within reality.
Mm-hmm.
And when that happens, you know, we're lost for a time. I mean, there have been times of dark ages here on this planet, and I think we're about to go into another one.
Mm-hmm. I agree with that also. And I think it has something to do with doing the spiritual work ahead of time. At least in it's my impression that things are a lot easier transition-wise when you've done the work already and you can kind of flow on a higher level of consciousness versus all this, what I call as a distraction. It seems like they're creating this disruption to distract our attention and pull us away from what we're supposed to be doing on a higher level. And I think that's kind of what you were talking about.
Absolutely. And what I find fascinating is, you know, and of course, for me, the church is a huge corporation.
Mm-hmm.
And they don't want you to think for yourself. They don't want you to question. They don't want you to say, you know, well, the angels were extraterrestrials. Although the Catholic Church does acknowledge there are UFOs and extraterrestrials now, but you know, I think that as a whole, we as a culture are so far behind where we're supposed to be. And I think it's because we've been so manipulated and so lied to. Look at our history books. Our histories don't have history in them. They have, they're storybooks.
Mm-hmm.
that somebody made up. They have nothing to do with actual history. Christopher Columbus was a mass murderer. Nobody talks about that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the giants were here before the Native American Indians were. Nobody talks about that.
Exactly. We're going to be talking about that in the next hour, by the way.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, but you're so right. You're so right. Everything has been edited and censored, and I've addressed this also in some of my books as well. And it's funny because a lot of people don't realize that, and they're kind of like innocent. You know, they don't realize that there's this big wall of deception that's been surrounding them, you know, since their birth.
Yeah, and it's just it floors me. It really floors me that we're stuck here. And, you know, I sit and I look back and I look at my childhood, which was not the greatest, but it was not the worst. And I look at the freedom that I had as a child. My mother would say in the summertime, come back when the streetlights come on.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's when I would come home. And now my grandchildren have to be chaperoned all the time. They're never let, you know, they're never allowed out to you know, go and play with friends. If they go and play with friends, they have to be taken and they have to be picked up. And they, mm-hmm. you know, there's just, life is changing so unbelievably. And it's so sad because the world as we knew it just is no longer there anymore.
I totally agree. Yeah.
And I, you know, maybe every generation says that and feels that.
Well, I know, but I do. Yeah.
Well, what I love, Albert Einstein had a great quote, and the intuitive mind, that would be our higher consciousness, is a sacred gift, and the rational mind is a faithful servant. Mm-hmm. And we've created a society that honors the servant and has forgotten the gift.
Well said, indeed. I totally agree with you. And with that being said, we're going to have for a break real quick. We'll be right back. Everybody stay tuned with Barbara DeLong, Hyperspace. Welcome back, everybody, to Dark Matter Radio Network. I'm your host, Solaris BlueRaven, and I'm here with my very special guest, Barbara DeLong. And Barbara, are you with me?
I am.
Excellent. And I just want to thank you again for being on the show tonight. You know, it's really nice to hear you talk, your words of wisdom. It's very important to hear this right now on this timeline, because there's not a lot of that going on right now. There's a lot of turmoil and a lot of other things that are spiking up right now. So I appreciate you. And give everybody a rundown insofar as your website goes and also your books.
The website is barbaradelong.com. It's a teaching site, and there's a lot of information on there, spiritual stuff. And not only that, but the secrets of the stone stuff and the giant stuff and some poetry that I wrote and lots of articles on different aspects of spirituality and a little bit of everything, actually.
That's wonderful.
I like to say it's from unicorns to UFOs and everything in between.
That's magical for sure, without a doubt. So let's switch gears into the giants. I'm always fascinated about the giants, and I know you've done extensive research in this area. Now, my one question to you is, why is it that we can't seem to locate any of these skeletons?
I mean, it's a conspiracy, of course. Mm-hmm. I would say that conspiracy runs rampant with our government. During the 1800s, when we were clearing out the West so that those of us who were civilized could go in and take over from the Native Americans, there were wars, and the army was sent in to wipe out the natives, mm-hmm. for want of a better word. And they did just that, but unfortunately, they were also fighting alongside the Indians. The Native Americans were giants, and they were killed as well. And when the government realized, and the natives, of course, had white skin, the giants had white skin, and all of the giants that I have heard of had white skin, and so the government had the bodies all shipped back to the Smithsonian, and of course they haven't been heard from since. And over in the 1800s, there were thousands, sometimes 10,000 bones of giants that were found. They were discarded. They were thrown away. Some of them were actually found in exploration of the Smithsonian itself, and the bones were sent back to the museum, and they now don't exist. So the Smithsonian is definitely hiding something. And at first, you know, I thought, well, that's just ridiculous. But the more I read, the more often I found that they would take, and especially with the mounds, a lot of the giants were buried in mounds in the Ohio Valley area, around that area. And they were, the giants were buried sitting up facing the east to greet the morning sun. And giants, let me explain what a giant is. First of all, obviously it's not your fee, fi, fo, fum giant. These were large people. And my theory, my understanding is at this point in time is that originally they inhabited the biblical lands, and they were driven out, and they were driven to the north and to the west, so that they eventually went through England, and then they, by ship, I believe, came to this country and were in North America, that's Canada and North America, for thousands of years before the Native Americans came across the land bridge. And they came across the land bridge in about 15,000 years ago. When they came into this country, they had to fight the Indians. The Indians had to fight the giants for the land. Sometimes they integrated into the tribes, other times they didn't. Now these giants were anywhere from 8 feet to 15 feet tall. They had extra digits on their hands and feet, and they had double rows of teeth. Now, the cool thing is, today you find lots of people who have, usually it's fair hair, either blonde or red. You will find people who have the fair skin and the fair hair. You will find some that have the extra digits and the double rows of teeth. So, in a way, we are the descendants of the giants. Mm-hmm. It's in our DNA. So, what happened in a lot of those studies? They took the artifacts, and they're in the Smithsonian, but the bones have been lost. Mm-hmm. Now, in the 1500s, there was a cave in Germany called the Breitenwiener Cave. And that was the burial ground for thousands of giants. And it was during World War II, Vietnam. At some point in time, there was an army base there. It's after World War II, because there was a concentration camp right by that cave during the war. And then after the war, there was a United Nations camp there with troops there. And the cave was off limits. And there's written documentation from the 1500s that the cave was there. It had giant bones in it. The heads were so big you could put them over your own head. And they're all over the place. And in the 1800s, thousands were dug up. When they were plowing fields, when they were laying railroad tracks, they found they found the sites of huge wars, and they found 10,000 sometimes bones of giants.
Oh my goodness.
So it's not, we're not talking one or two or 10 or 15 or 20 or 100. We're talking thousands of them were here on this continent before the Native American Indians came in.
That's fascinating. And did the Native Americans associate them with sky people at all? Do you know?
Not to my knowledge, no.
Okay.
I mean, the Native Americans do talk of the sky people, certainly, mm-hmm. but the giants were not a part of it. I think that they were a segment, you know, in our history that's just been lost, and I don't know why the history books don't acknowledge it. I think it's so cool.
Oh, I do too. It's so frustrating. I swear, like you said, everything is so censored and edited. We might as well just throw every book out and just burn it at this point in the continuum, because everything's so off base, you know.
Well, even in the pyramids, there are petroglyphs of giants.
Mm-hmm.
Also petroglyphs of electric lights. So you go figure that one out.
Right.
And down in South America, there are petroglyphs down there of giants being a part of some of their society. So giants have lived in harmony with us as human beings in our past history. And when the Korean kid took over from his father, and they did a review of the troops, there was a picture of the mass of all these soldiers, you know, standing at attention, and you see little head, little head, little head. Oops, big, then little head, little head. There's a giant in the army.
Wow.
I mean, they're still here. There's not only were they among us, they are among us. And what have we done in our great wisdom, you know, evolved as we are? We put them in the circus and called them a freak.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Right.
I mean, really.
Yeah, it's so backwards, I swear. Do you think there's any correlation between those long structures and the giants that you've been researching?
The giants, you mean, they're too small for the giants.
Okay, so it's not something they would have a connection to.
No, but, okay. but, if you look in England at the stone structures there, mm-hmm. I truly believe that that they actually constructed Stonehenge. There's no other way to explain how the rocks, first of all, got there, and second of all, were put up, unless it was a giant that did it. And some of the giants in the past stood as many as 20 feet, 30 feet high.
Wow.
When Moses was going to take the people into the land of milk and honey, to Canaan, and they sent out scouts to see, you know, what was going on in the land that God had given them. They came back and they said they didn't want to go there because there were giants. And it's in the Bible that you know, they looked upon us as grasshoppers. They could walk under between the legs of these giants without ducking. So that the Israelites had to fight the giants for the land that God gave them.
Mm-hmm.
It's in the Bible.
It's fascinating. Well, it reminds me of the Greek gods as well, and mm-hmm. Mount Olympus and everything else. But it's really, really fascinating to me. But how do you think the giants were eliminated?
Well, I think they were driven out. Mm-hmm. It, you know, for those that assimilated into the different tribes and stuff like that, they probably died out. I would say that We are the descendants of giants. I think that they are definitely they intermarried into the general populace to the point that sooner, you know, we got smaller and smaller. I think we have gotten smaller and smaller and smaller. I think that our ancestors were the giants.
Mm-hmm. I agree with you on that one. It makes me wonder also if what correlation they have to the star systems, which star system that they originated from. Do you have any ideas?
Well, actually, it's said that the giants are the ones that brought language and math and astronomy to those of us that are here.
Makes
sense. So that they were the ones that brought all of those aspects, the mathematics and the knowledge of the stars and the knowledge of the plants and things like that. They were brought through the giants. And when you go back to Atlantis and the fact that the Atlanteans, I believe, were giants as well.
Mm-hmm. Didn't they talk about the golden giants as well? Didn't they?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you know, and if that's the case, I was on somebody's round table and they were talking about the statues in Egypt of these, you know, the huge, tall statues and everything. And I said, did it ever occur to you that those aren't just, you know, blowing somebody out of proportion? They could be just life-size replications.
Thank you, because I think the same thing.
So, I mean, you know, that's what they look like. You know, right. you do a sculpture of me, you do a statue of me, you're going to make me my height. You're not going to make me 20, 30, 40, 50, 60 feet high. I think that a lot of those statues of their gods and stuff like that were life size.
Mm-hmm. I totally agree with you on that one. Very much so. And also the sarcophagus, there's those big, they look like a sarcophagus where you could put a giant, lie one down in one. You know what
the ones
about?
The ones that they say were for the bulls. They,
right.
They
yeah.
They were for that's bullshit. I'm sorry. That's ridiculous. No, they can't. Mm-hmm. No, they. There are no bones in any of them. I think they were either initiation chambers or chambers for moving into another realm, or, you know, what's the word I'm looking for? Transporters.
Right.
I mean, I could see getting into one of those and having the lid slammed down and having, you know, a tractor beam come and get you that way. But, mm-hmm. but there are too many of them. But you're right. They could have put a giant in one of those too.
Mm-hmm.
But there were no bones in any of them.
Right. That's it. It's like everything.
And no mummies in any of the pyramids. Mm-hmm. So that, you know, I don't know why they call them burial chambers, because there were no mummies. There were no bodies in them.
Right. No. I think we all know that the pyramid is a big generator, you know, power source.
Well, yeah. And also somebody said at one point that it could be a water pump. Because there is water, there's a chamber that goes down, and there is water at the bottom of that chamber. So, and the Nile may well have come up higher, so that it would have been conceivable that it could be used as a water pump of some sort.
That's a good point to make. Yeah. Also, like floating from one area to the next. You were talking about the encapsulation of someone. You could use a little a tube of some kind, put somebody in there, and float them from one area to the next through the underwater canals.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so I see it like that also. Yeah, there's definitely a lot there that they haven't addressed, and I think obviously have covered up deliberately. And now it seems to be more difficult to get in there and do any more research.
Well, I don't know why they haven't just dug under the Sphinx, to tell you the truth.
Well, I think they have. They probably just won't, you know, in certain areas. I'm pretty sure they've probably already done that, wouldn't you say?
Probably. It's another one of those things that we're probably never going to know about.
Right. Well, unfortunately, you know, it takes wisdom to comprehend the information that's been left behind. And I'm not too certain that these people really understand what they get their hands on. You know, it's kind of like, reminds me of Indiana Jones, you know, the first one, where they really don't know what they have, but they're just playing with it. And that's what I'm seeing here, you know, just like children with toys that they haven't created.
So. Well, you know, they make reference to the fact that the governments have been in contact with the extraterrestrials. I don't believe that.
I don't either.
I really believe if the extraterrestrials are going to contact anybody, they're going to contact the bulk of humanity, and I believe they'll do it telepathically.
You bet. You're spot on that one. Yeah, I'm a firm believer, after what I know about the covert technology, that they're actually creating their own version of an extraterrestrial race through the synthetic telepathy and psychotronic artificial intelligence, which will mirror and create a false race of extraterrestrials, which has nothing to do with any universe or star system species. So
it'll just be another way of manipulating all of us.
Right. Well, see, you're ahead of the game, and so am I, and people who are listening will obviously be ahead of the game as well. But yeah, I do see the agenda, and I do see it's almost like there's a war for the spirit and the soul, because with that comes all the multidimensional mastery we all contain, obviously. And that, of course, is a threat, as you were stating earlier. You know, the truth is really hard to digest for people sometimes.
Well, you know, the hardest thing, I think, for most people to grasp. And I know with the spiritual development circle, I'm constantly hitting my head against the wall, but with it, because, you know, people say, you know, oh, yes, we are a part of God. Okay, that makes you a God. And you know, it's sort of like they say, yeah, but he's out there. And I didn't know it's inside of you. You are God. Right. And that if you are praying to something, you are giving your power away.
Thank you.
It just, you know, and I've often said, you know, if you're looking for the little the guy in the white robe with the beard sitting on a cloud, you're not going to find that. It's inside, and if you go inside, you can find the wisdom of all time. You can find so much magic, so much power, and you want to levitate, you can levitate. You want to, you know, you want to teleport yourself, so you can do that. I mean, what do you think astral projection is?
Mm-hmm. Exactly. And the Godhead is the crown chakra.
Yeah. And I mean, so, yeah. You know, it's kind of like, there. I love this story. The gods, you know, hear the S, got together and created humanity in their own likeness. And after it was done, they realized that they had done exactly that. They had created us in their likeness with all the power, with all the everything, all the bells and whistles. And there was no just standard edition. It was bells and whistles, everything, exact replicas of what they were capable of. And they decided that they couldn't actually activate and turn us loose with that knowledge, because we were too young, and that kind of power could destroy us. And it could. Sure, it could today. But so they decided they had to hide the knowledge that power was inside of them from us. And they start, the debate went on for eons, centuries, millennia, whatever. And every time they thought they had a place, there was something that would discount it. You know, on the moon, nah, he'll fly eventually and get there and find it. Or in deepest sea, nope, they're going to go there too. Curiosity will get the, you know, he'll go there and he'll discover it. And so finally an old crone who was sick and tired of listening to them talk wandered in and said, I will tell you where you can hide the wisdom that they are just exactly like us. And they said, where? She said, hide it inside. They'll never look there.
Mm-hmm.
And it's inside. It's there. We have the capabilities of the gods, whoever they were. Mm-hmm. And it's just, I mean, Tibetan monks have levitated.
Right.
I mean, there have been parts of our population that have over time done any number of amazing things. Look at science fiction, Star Trek, way long ago, their communication things, you know, was what cell phones are. The doors that open when they came close to them and close after them. You hit that in every mall today, but 20 years ago or whenever, it was magic. No, we're capable of so much more. It's so frustrating.
It is, and it seems like we're going into the dark ages. That's what frustrates me the most, is that with all of this wisdom and consciousness, I think people are lost. I don't think they understand their potential, first of all. They haven't been taught it, and nobody's really communicating this, and thank goodness you're on the planet, because there aren't very many who can actually relay the data. Seriously.
Well, you know, like I said before, we're pre-programmed to not be creative. We're pre-programmed to not think for ourselves.
Right.
And you know, have you read any of Zachariah Sitchin's books?
No, I never got into him, and I'm probably going to get shot down for that. But not.
No, yeah. No. I mean, because I can trash him up.
Oh, upside. Yay! I don't feel bad now. Okay.
Yeah. Let's see. He got his degree in economics. He was bilingual only because he spoke Hebrew and English, and he happened to be Jewish. So big surprise there. And he wrote science fiction.
Mm-hmm.
And he wrote good science fiction. Why people suddenly think that a race is coming to get our gold when there's an asteroid out there that's 100% gold that has more than a million times the amount of gold on Earth, and it's just in an asteroid, they can just go there and get it. I mean, none of the stuff makes sense. And he wasn't even a biblical scholar. He got things he quoted things wrong, mm-hmm. And you know, frankly, he was as surprised as I am that people worship him and have memorized his stuff.
Right.
We weren't created as slaves, but our government is making us slaves now.
Oh, totally. Well, the interpolation of the data was, in my opinion, not correct. You know, and I can always tell. My radar knows what's right and what's not. I just have that natural benchmark from the universe. And my impression of what he was saying also, I mean, even with like a lot of people talk about the Anunnaki and this and that, and I just don't resonate with any of that data. It doesn't feel true to me. It doesn't resonate. And the more I see it, it's like one person says one word and somebody else runs with it. And by the time you get to the end of the line, it's a totally different conversation, which has nothing to do with what's really happening here in our space time.
Exactly. And that's why George Norrie bothers me, because in the Ancient Aliens series, way back when it started, he was quoting Sitchin all over the place.
Yeah,
and,
I know.
And now he's talking the exact opposite. Now, I mean, okay, he learned the truth, or his source got proved wrong, or I just it bothers me. You know, pick a place and stand on it. Don't go with whatever the flow is.
Totally agree. Well, I think there's a majority rules kind of a tribe that goes on where people just resonate with one thing and it's not correct, but then they run with it and then everybody kind of perpetuates it, and then it becomes this big, you know, thing where they classify it as a truth when in fact it's not even close to the truth. I do see that a lot. And it's better to be accurate and truthful and be kind of behind the scenes opposed to being out there just getting completely butchered by all this, you know, exaggeration, in my opinion.
Well, I, you know, what gets me is it made people afraid of extraterrestrials.
Right.
And for no reason. And I've been in the field a long time. And to be honest with you, I mean, I've not met anyone that has genuinely seen a UFO that has had a negative experience. As a matter of fact, I think that it has opened them up to so much so much amazing material inside of themselves that it's of great benefit and great joy. I truly believe that people that are truly, truly on a spiritual path, that's not saying it, that's living it, walking it. Yeah, living it and walking it, you know, walking the talk, for God's sake. Mm-hmm. And I believe those people actually have longer lifetimes. They are more joyful. They see more light. They experience more amazing things all over the place. And you know, it's sort of like things like the Sitchkin stuff, things like the, you know, fear-mongering. And I understand fear sells.
Yep, right. Well, you know, the contactees are always tracked by covert intelligence because they like to do damage control. And that's the bottom line. I mean, a lot of, and I agree with you 100%. I think true contactees, true people who experience the crafts, spacecraft, whatever, or the species, always have a positive experience. My knowing is that whatever is negative is coming from the underground and their manipulation and their warfare, their hardware that's based on psychotronics. So that's something I'm very, very clear on. So that's where I think that's becoming a distortion. And I will tell you one thing. I never hear anybody besides myself, maybe two others, that talk about the covert intelligence assault program. They always want to dump it on the extraterrestrials. They never talk about what we have as hardware that's used to manipulate the mind and psychic energy centers. And I think that's a disservice, honestly, you know.
Well, you know, it's scary because, you know, I have to say my opinion a lot because I don't speak for anybody other than myself. So if somebody takes offense, take offense with me. But you know, it's my position today. Tomorrow it may be different. But I really believe that governments originally were put in place to have armies to protect the country from intruders, and they have morphed into a controlling, you know, organization to keep all of us in line. And the one thing you haven't brought up that you know, I do want to throw out there, what about the 800 concentration camps that are manned by the army that are all over this country?
Mm-hmm.
What are they for?
Exactly.
I mean, when Katrina hit and when Sandy hit, I mean, if they're for our population in times of danger and stress and everything, why weren't the people sent there? Why were they sent to a football stadium to you know, be crammed together with no bathrooms? Why didn't the government just open some of those camps to these refugees so that they could have a place to sleep and food to eat?
Mm-hmm. Good point.
I mean, they're all over the place and they're manned. Mm-hmm. And so who are they for or what are they for? I mean, I've heard lots of different philosophies, but the government isn't saying anything. They're advertising. I will admit, I saw an advertisement for they were looking for people to come in and act as guards. And one of the questions they were asked is, would you shoot a United States citizen?
Oh, lovely.
Yeah.
Well, unfortunately, I think that's the dark path we're walking down, unfortunately, as a country, and I don't like to see it going in that direction. But I really believe, you know, we are the star people. I mean, that's what we are here. We're not just regular humanoids. We're star beings. And I do believe that poses a threat when you're fully activated on a level of higher consciousness, just like our ancestors. So to me, that would explain why they do damage control. That would explain why they have their secrets. And that explains why they control and manipulate the masses' mind, because they don't want that energy going to the highest level, which would be, they don't need to be around. They get disempowered by our knowledge and our wisdom and, of course, our multidimensional mastery.
Oh yeah, and it's just it's frightening. Mm-hmm. But you know, to on a more positive note, I'm finding more and more people curious and wanting to work on their spiritual development, wanting to understand, you know, the right. Everybody has their own path, and everybody finds their own path on their own. But to give them the tools so that they can actually find that pathway is a very exciting thing.
It certainly is. And nowadays, there's so much interference being run. I think it's significant that there's information out there like yours that's accessible so people can search and actually find information that's going to help them on their spiritual path, because I certainly don't see it from day to day in mainstream. People are very, very lost from what I've observed. But I would like to discuss your book, Whispers of Spiritual Wisdom, which I guess is a collection of your poetry.
It's a collection of poetry and spiritual vignettes.
Nice.
Actually, Patrick saw all of my poetry smushed in one place, and he started to read through it, and he said, this is good. You should publish it. And I kind of, you know, looked at him and said, oh, don't be silly. It's just, you know, free verse and it's not a big deal. And he kept pushing me. And I finally said, all right, but you can't just put out a book of poetry. There's got to be, you know, something that they can get their teeth into. And so I put together just one page spurts of philosophy. And it's channeled material. And so, I mean, I jokingly say it's a great bathroom book because you can read one page and you can close it and, you know, you don't have to, there's, you can open it and read something and shut it and, you know, open it in a different place the next day. And it was my intent was to give people something to think about. And, you know, not give them all the answers because I don't have them. I know all the questions. I just don't have most of the answers. Mm-hmm. And to give them something to ponder. And so Patrick published it. And the book cover and back is really a picture out of our bathroom window at dawn. Mm. And it's, you know, it's not the book I intended to write. You know, I knew I had a book to write, but that wasn't it. Mm-hmm. And so I still have that other book inside of me, I guess. But it was really exciting because when I put it together, I just, you know, sent a note out to all of the show hosts that had been on Patrick's show and my show. And I said, I just published a book and I want to publicize it. You know, can you give me a short piece of time in your show? And what fascinated me was, you know, a lot of the women that I knew well that I had read on their shows and stuff, they all said, oh, absolutely. And we talked about it and they were very complimentary. But the paranormal guys were even better because these were most of the men that I had met through Patrick. They were into UFOs for sure and conspiracy and everything else. And so I always send a book to the host and I said, you know, here's what the book is, so you know what we're talking about. And to all of their credit, to even the sports guys that decided to have me on and interview me, to their extreme credit and my thanks, they all read the book. And they had, you know, marked certain pages with questions.
Nice.
I had one guy that said, I don't read these books, but I'll give it to my wife. And when he interviewed me, he said, I have to admit, I picked it up and I read it. And he had wonderful, insightful questions. And it was an amazing experience to, you know, I knew I was sometimes going to be talking about the Yankees more than I was talking about the book, but that was never the case. Whoever had me on their shows were absolutely so respectful of the spiritual aspects of the book that it was profound. And you know, it's not exactly a bestseller, but it does sell. And it's really, you know, and it's, that's thanks to Patrick, because I didn't think they were worth a damn.
Oh, well, you know, I tend to think poetry is a lost art these days. You know, not many take the time to center and allow these celestial energies, what I call celestial energies, of inspiration to flow through their being. And to me, poetry is pure magic. And I find that there's a lot of truth in the information when you're running energy for that.
Oh, so, absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
So how many people do you know write poetry these days? I certainly don't know very many.
No, I totally agree with you. And it just, you know, it's, I think a lot of stuff is a lost art these days with being able to, you know, Google everything, the art of actually writing or actually channeling. Actually, I'm working with a whole bunch of people on teaching them how to channel, teaching them how to get to that connection with their higher consciousness inside. And it's really exciting.
That's awesome. Is there a noise there?
Yeah, a cat. Sorry.
Oh, okay. It's always a feline around or a dog. That's fine.
Absolutely.
And what year did you start writing the poetry?
Actually, all of the poetry in the book came from, we have to go back to the 80s when I started doing mandalas, painting mandalas for people and writing the life readings that went along with them. And on occasion, poetry came out.
Mm. And that's your cosmic deck of initiation?
Well, it ended up in that it started out as personal mandalas. And now you have to understand, I have no art training. Mm-hmm. None. And I've never written poetry. So, you know, the fact that those two things came up is really kind of amusing to me. But, you know, happily, you know, you get to a point in time where you just go with the flow. And so with painting the mandalas, it got to a point where I actually had to start to charge to slow down the demand for them because it was overwhelming. Mm-hmm. And I think ultimately there were about 500 of them that I actually painted that are all over the world. And I think we have pictures of maybe 300 of them on the Mandela Gallery on the website. And so at one point in time, I was doing psychic fairs and during that time, the only cards decks that were out there were really the Rider-Waite and the Aquarian and Mother Peace, and then mine. Mine was the second circular deck ever published. And I just kept saying, and at that time I was doing gem casting.
Nice.
To read by. And I would say after the fairs, we'd all get together and we'd have some wine and we'd have, you know, we'd eat Italian or something. And I would ultimately say, you know, I just don't understand, you know, the tarot deck. It to me, it you have to be a really great practitioner in order to really get a joyful, positive, happy reading from it. Mm-hmm. And there are those that can do that. Absolutely. I wasn't reading with many of them, but there are people that can. And they finally got together and they did what I call a psychic intervention. They told me to stop drinking wine, stop trashing their decks, or create this deck that I kept talking about that would be a light energy deck.
Oh,
and so 9 months later, I had the deck made and I threw it down on the table. I had mocked it up and I said, go ahead. You know, here's the layout. Here's how you do it. And you just give me some of your negative stuff. And they couldn't do it. They couldn't. So I started trashing their decks again. And the deck was never meant to be published, actually. Mm-hmm. It just, a friend of mine had a restaurant and I had done some readings there. And she said, there's a lady here that wants a reading. You want to get a free dinner and come over and read for her. And I went over and the woman said, do you have an extra deck? And I said, yeah. And she said, could I, you know, borrow it for a day or so? And I said, sure. And because I knew where she ate. And I got a call from Stuart Kaplan, who owns US Games, that at the time published almost all of the tarot decks that were out there. Mm-hmm. And he wanted to publish the deck.
Nice.
And, you know, I said, why? He said, I like the artwork.
Mm-hmm. It's beautiful.
So that's how the deck got published. It was, yeah. And, you know, it's taken me on an over 20-year ride. I mean, so many cool things happen because the deck is out there. And at the time I said to him, it's a sleeper. It's going to be 20 years before people understand what it's all about. Mm-hmm. And that brings us to this point in time. And though it is no longer published, there are still decks available out there. And I find people writing me all the time about the deck, and I'm fascinated by it.
Mm-hmm. It's beautiful, beautiful energy transmitting through those designs. There's no doubt.
Yes, they can make you dizzy, yes.
Well, it almost reminds me of multidimensional gateways. I mean, there's just so much. There's so many levels to it on a consciousness design. It's just really pretty. Yeah, I encourage people to check your website and look at that. That's phenomenal.
It is a cool deck. Mm-hmm. And what I like about it, it gives you a 12-month reading, and you have past, present, future, and you have body, mind, and spirit. You have the 12 houses of the, you know, the astrology 12 houses are all there, so that you can actually, I think the longest time I ever read one person was 6 hours.
My goodness.
And it just, you know, there's always more material to get. Mm-hmm. And to give. And you know, so it's a great deck, because especially for those people that say, I can't be read. And I love those people.
Yeah. That's funny. There are people like that out there.
I know. They just sit there and I'm closing my fields. And it's like, go ahead.
Wormhole.
Yeah, I mean, it's just, I don't know. There are those people. I love skeptics. I think they're fabulous. I think I adore skeptics. Mm-hmm. I love people who say I can't be read. I think they're great. And I even more love those people that sit in front of me and say, this is my last incarnation on Earth. I don't have to come back. Mm-hmm. And you know, I just look at them and say, well, you're right, and then you're wrong. And you know, they look at me and I say, your personality will never be on this Earth plane again, for sure. Mm-hmm. Your spirit may have other things to say about it.
That's so true, isn't it? Yeah. Well, I certainly hope the world changes for the better before anybody comes back to this sector.
Well, you know, it's an exciting time to be here. It's a phenomenal place to energetically. Mm-hmm. I mean, the surges of energy are just incredible, especially, you know, full moons and stuff like that. But I'm finding the energy increasing. I'm finding the element of time being compressed. It's almost as though I want to put an extra day in the week. Mm-hmm. Because everything seems to be, you know, rushing so.
And, right, speeding up.
Yes, it's amazing.
I agree with you on that one. It's definitely feeling like an acceleration. But at the same time, I don't feel too empathic to the frequency, but I do recognize it.
Do you find you don't need as much sleep?
Yes, for sure. As a matter of fact, I'm really concerned myself sometimes because I don't sleep at all at night. I mean, maybe 5 hours if I'm lucky.
Yeah, that's about what I get, you know, 4 to 5 hours. And, you know, and suddenly the eyes are wide open and it's like, you know, I don't have to do spiritual stuff. I could, you know, clean the house or fold the laundry, but I'm totally vitalized and I'm awake. Right. And it's hard to just lay there and clench your teeth and saying, no, I have to sleep more. And man, and then when you wake up, you're groggy because mm-hmm. you've actually forced yourself to sleep during a time frame when you should have been awake and functional.
I so agree with you on that. And I've experienced that myself. Now, have you ever worked with gem elixirs?
Yes and no. My gemstones, the pouch that I have is, it's really a bigger pouch than it started out. It's got diamonds, rubies, emeralds, sapphires, and you know, all the other kinds of stones in there. And some are faceted and some are not. I have from time to time dropped a couple of them into water and just let the sun shine on them for as many hours as I could. Mm-hmm. They do work.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I've tried them. So I was curious if you had worked with those before. Yeah, definitely feel a difference in my frequency for sure.
Absolutely. And what I find too is, you know, there's so much. Recently, I live on a pond and in the woods, and I have some really, really resonant wind chimes out there that you can feel them when they chime. You can feel the vibration in the air. And I don't know if it's just me or if it's everybody, but I'm finding that energetically, just everything resonates more, and you can almost see the waves.
Right. I agree with you on that. Yeah.
And it's so cool. And it's sort of like, I know we're coming to a shift and a change. And I know it's energetic. I'm not sure what's happening, you know, as far as the mundane reality goes, whether the governments are going to rise or fall or what's going to happen. But I do know on a consciousness level that space between the ego, the lower consciousness, and the higher consciousness, the link with all of eternity, the bridges are going to be there. There are bridges for a lot of us now, but the connection is going to be made. And I sometimes wonder just what will humanity do when those who aren't ready for it get it.
Right. Yeah, that's going to be a whole different reality for them.
going to be very interesting.
For sure. Well, there's, I'm sure you're familiar with the spinoff where we go into two different dimensional spaces or worlds or universes, whatever you want to call it. And one is the full light universe and the other one is the orotronic, which is incomplete. What is your impression of that? Do you think there's some truth to that where those who have not truly ascended in consciousness will go into a different universe, which is not bad. It's not evil. It's just incomplete. So they can continue on in their progressions.
I don't know. I'm more of a feeling that it isn't until every single person on this planet is at that same place and there is no war and there is peace that we'll be ready to be allowed into that cosmic brotherhood. We are a family. We are all one. And I think we either sink or swim as one.
Mm-hmm. It's really hard to sync everybody up, I'll tell you that much. It would take a massive UFO to come.
Well, you know, the thing is, this planet has been rinsed and re-terraformed at least two, if not three times.
Right. Yeah.
So if we screw up, you know, humanity just may not be the species that makes it.
I agree with you on that one.
Now, I mean, our souls, our spirits... I mean, when you stop and think about it, etherically speaking, when the souls were scattered throughout the universe, they took form in the form they took upon whatever planet they landed or asteroid or whatever. They took the form that was indigenous to that particular atmosphere and environment. Mm-hmm. So that you know, on Earth, this is the form we took. But had our spirit landed on, I don't know, planet X someplace, not planet X, bad analogy, on another planet, that etherically speaking, we pulled into form that which would be able to survive in that climate, that atmosphere, and that planet.
Right.
So.
Defined by frequency, pretty much, I would say.
Yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. So you know, when they talk about different physical characteristics and everything, that makes perfect sense to me because the gravitational pull is not the same, the atmosphere is not the same, the flora, the fauna is not the same. It takes a different shape and form to survive.
I agree.
But the consciousness inside is the same as the consciousness inside of us.
Mm-hmm.
So if this planet doesn't make it and they decide to re-terraform it and start over again, our spirits will just go someplace else.
I agree. Yep. That's the good side of it, actually.
Yes.
Maybe we are done here. So tell me about your radio show, Nightlight. I love the name, Nightlight.
I decided to do Nightlight when I found out how easy it was to run the switchboard. Mm. And I figured... You know, I didn't have exactly a following, but I could certainly talk for two straight hours if I had to, if nobody called in. And I just thought it would be my way of expanding my world, my universe. And some lady came up to me. I was doing a cable TV show, and she was very full of herself because her TV show had, you know, X amount of people in the viewing audience, which meant she had two little villages. And she said, and I understand you have a little radio show. And I said, I do. And she said, what's your listening audience? And I said, I don't know. And she said, no demographics. I said, no, I just don't know what the population of the world is.
So, burn.
So I created Nightlight. And it was meant and is supposed to be a way of my giving back. And so I do readings on the show. I do interviews with book authors. I do all kinds of stuff with it. And it's a very exciting way for me to put information out there. There have been a couple of shows. There was one show where something was wrong and nobody called in and there was nobody in the chat room. So and the show used to be 11 o'clock to 1 in the morning. So I read Humanity. And I spent 2 hours reading Humanity, and it's probably one of the most popularly archived shows out there.
Oh, wow. Great.
I figured, all right, I'm going to give you what Spirit says, you know, humanity should hear, and I did that for 2 hours. But there is happily a following now, and from that show came the Spiritual Development Circle. And because I felt that there was a need for more education on the foundations of spirituality, and that's a lot of fun. Mm-hmm. And it's just my way of giving back. I've been very, very fortunate, and life has been good. I'm not rich as far as money goes, but as far as spirit goes, I'm a millionaire. And I truly love doing the readings, and of course people become my guinea pigs when I decide that, you know, let me do this differently and let me do that differently. It's a lot of fun to experiment. And as it stands now, I don't allow them to ask questions. I give them what spirit gives me, and explain to them that whatever the mundane problems that are going on in their lives, if they let spirit talk to them without restricting the information that they possibly could get, what's even more important for them to be able to deal with their realities themselves.
I so agree with you. You know what? We're getting ready to wrap this up soon enough, and I know we still need to talk about the Emerald Tablets, and I wanted to talk about Niagara's Ancient Cemetery of Giants. So what I'm going to have to do is have you back.
Oh, that would be fun.
Yeah, because you're phenomenal. I'm so appreciative of you. I think we have like 5 minutes, and I don't know how much we can cover in that 5 minutes. But if you want to kind of touch base a little bit on let's just talk a little bit about the Niagara's Ancient Cemetery. And, of course, I do want to make sure everybody knows how to get in touch with you again. Let's give them a rundown of your website one more time.
It's barbaradelong.com. It's very hard.
There you go.
Well, it's you know, Niagara Cemetery. Well, there are cemeteries of giants all over the country, and that's one of them. Actually, one of the more interesting ones, though, would be the Nevada one, where the Paiutes herded all of the giants into a cave. It's in the Paiute history, you know, verbal history, that they chased all of the giants into this cave, and then they built bonfires so that the giants suffocated. And it's just one of their legends, and everybody thought, you know, yeah, right. And so in Nevada, there some guano farmers were looking for caves and that had guano deposits that they could mine because they use it for fertilizer, among other things. And so they found this cave in Nevada that was had a rich deposit, so to speak. And as they were mining it out, they came across, you know, arrowheads and spearheads and stuff like that. And they put them aside because it was interesting artifacts. And then they came upon pottery, and then they came upon giant bones. And the cave was full of giant bones. And it was the bones of the giants that had been herded into the cave. And I think it makes us more and more realize that the mythology that we have grown up with, the fairy tales that we have grown up with, most probably are absolute truth.
Mm-hmm. It's amazing. Well, weren't they red-haired also? Was that the one?
Yes. They were red-haired, double rows of teeth, extra digits.
That's fascinating to me. It's just incredible. My goodness. Well, I don't know how much time we have left here. Let's see. We're probably doing pretty good still. Well, can you give us just a little bit of a teaser on the Emerald Tablets?
Emerald Tablets of Thoth. They've been in existence. They've been written about from between the 6th and 8th centuries, the very first time they've ever appeared in writing. They are theoretically the Emerald Tablets that hold the wisdom of Atlantis. And that they were written by Thoth, left beneath the Great Pyramid for a time when humanity was ready for the truths. They have been known to be the foundation for the Hermetica, which was the, you know, ancient alchemical stuff from the Middle Ages. That's where the as above, so below comes from. And according to Dr. Dural in 1925, he translated them, and it's actually the story of creation and how the Atlanteans, who were giants, when Atlantis went under the water, the only structure that was left, the very last to go under, was the Temple of Light, and so the master of the Temple of Light called Thoth to the temple with his people, and he sent them in his spaceship to the land of Kem, which was Egypt, and he, with his staff, he quieted the warring tribes there and convinced them that he was there to lead them into enlightenment. He taught them He taught them numbers and math. He taught them astrology. He taught them building skills and techniques. He taught them healing techniques. Now, this all is very reminiscent of the story in the Bible and the fallen angels and the different things that they taught humanity. And what's really cool is the Emerald Tablets of Thoth predate the Bible.
Perfect. And with that being said, we're running out of time here. Barbara, I'm going to have you back, but I want to thank you very much for being on tonight. It's been a wonderful, wonderful time with you. And please stay tuned, everybody, for Researcher on a Mission with Dr. J coming up next to sell you on. Oh, well, he's not going to sell us anywhere because he's still here on our timeline. So, but anyways, he's up next on Dark Matter Radio Network. And let's see here. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in. I hope you did appreciate the information. And Barbara, you're phenomenal. I had such a good time with you tonight.
Absolutely. My pleasure.
I want to really thank you again. And thank you, Keith, and everybody else. I think we're out of here just about.